during a lifetime. Okay? A kitchen faucet would need to be turned on all the way for at least 45 years to be equal to the amount of blood pumped by the heart in an average lifetime. Okay? And these are just statistics. I'm not going to get too much into it. The heartbeat that begins beating, look at number 9. The heart begins beating at 4 weeks after conception. So for those who believe in abortion, guess what? They are killing something live. People think just because it's not developed into a full baby in the mother's stomach, that it's not a live thing. It is upon conception. Okay. We're not going to get too much into the fact that why medical people believe that blood is actually like a connective tissue, but look at the picture on the bottom right. That's what your blood cells look like. Almost like donuts, but with the hole, without the hole. Cardiovascular disease isn't only about the heart. Did you know that women are affected more by cardiovascular diseases than men? Did you know that? Why do you think that is? Even though it's down there on the bottom.
Estrogen.
What do you know about estrogen? You're a man. Okay.
Higher fat levels.
Higher fat levels.
Higher cholesterol levels.
Talking about higher fat levels, the reason why, if you did a drinking contest between a man and a woman, the same amount of liquor, the woman would get drunk faster because of our fat content. Mm-hmm. Did you know that?
Mm-hmm.
Now you do. That doesn't mean you should try to test it like that. Okay, I was just saying, don't test it out, okay? Okay? Because of our fat, because of our hormones, you know, men, our hormones is a dangerous thing to you sometimes. So be careful with us when we go through those changes. Okay, we're affected more because of that. Women tend to be more, take stress and let it bother them more because they say that women are more relationship oriented. So we're more into the family, how they function, what they do. We worry about the children. We worry about the husband. We worry about our parents. We worry about this. Not that men don't. Women just do it more. And that affects our health. I guess that's why God made us stronger than men. No, wait. Okay, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying strong as obviously, men are stronger than us. But as far as what we take in life, we can take a lot more punches than you men. That's how they, well, after all, we're the ones who carry the baby, right? You men complain about a headache. We women have to complain about 9 months of carrying this. Okay, so God made us a whole lot stronger, even though we get a lot more issues and different issues than men do. Okay, and what it says up there, women are more likely to experience nausea, general fatigue, and shortness of breath. Okay? We also tend to worry about other people that when this happens to us, oh, don't worry, I'm too busy worrying about somebody else, the children, the parents, the husband, whatever. But what does it say? Unfortunately, many women don't know these warning signs, so they ignore them and don't get the help they need, at least in time. And so it's very important to pay attention to how you feel and know that you don't have to have chest pain or other intense symptoms, because what do they say is one of the first signs of a heart attack? Pain, or maybe pain of the arm, or something like that. If you get it, yes, it can be that, but a lot of times it's also dismissed as indigestion, okay? Well, and we'll talk about that another time. Okay, women often have symptoms different than from men. Unusual fatigue, sleep disturbance, shortness of breath, indigestion. Well, that sounds like a lot of other medical issues. Okay, but the point is, because we know that you have a lot put on you, women, from the rearing of the children, taking care of the husband, having a job, taking care of the parents sometimes, that you need to really, really take care of yourselves. It's really important. Take time for me. Find some me time in there somewhere, because it's important. And men, chill. Give the ladies that time. Children, stop it and let your parents have that time, especially your mom. Okay, facts and figures. I have to shrink it, but I should have left it alone. We're not talking about cigarette smoking. Anybody here smoke? No hands better go up. Okay, good. Anybody drink? Oh, water. I was going to say, don't raise that hand.
Kill a scotch.
Okay, so we don't have to worry about that. More women than men die of cardiovascular disease each year, again, because of all the things we spoke about. We live with it probably a lot longer, but we also die of it. We're not going to get too much into that. Look, on the left side are different diseases, and this is only a little list of things that can happen because of your heart. Recognize any of them, or anybody who knows some of them? Okay? What can we do to help?
Reduce stress.
Reduce stress. In fact, that's number one. Then the second one is your eating habits have a lot to do with it. Yes. Take out dairy. Absolutely. What does dairy have to do with hurting your heart?
Saturated fat. It stresses the heart. It has to overwork to process that saturated fats.
Now, are you a medical person or missionary? You're answering everything too right.
Okay. High sodium level also in the cheeses as
that's
well.
Right.
Genetically engineered corn that is transferred to the cow. That has hormones that alters the hormonal levels of the women, estrogen levels.
You want to get him to stand over here with this presentation?
Okay.
Very good. Your wife taught you well. Did she teach you that? Don't answer that. Okay, yes. There's lots of things other than what it says it up there. And you know, folks, we're so used to doing a lot of those things that it's become such a normal part of us that when somebody like me and other people come along and say, well, watch your sugar, honey, and watch your dairy. And say, well, what else is there to eat? Or I've been doing it all my life.
Author and a teacher.
Yeah, but you know what? What was the difference between cheese now and cheese whenever it came about?
Kickboxing.
Big difference. What's the difference between the cows back in the day and the cows now? Big difference. And I'm not talking about size either. I'm talking about what they do to these cows. And then you ingest them and their products. Okay, things are changing. You know, we talked about just briefly what not only the songs we were singing about our heart, but if we are to get to the point that we can think clearly in order to hear the Holy Spirit better, there are a lot of things we have to change in our lives. And it's like, oh no, here's another person talking about health again. Yes, it is about health. Because it's impossible for us to make any kind of decisions in life, whether it's at work or at home or at church or any place else, if we're so riddled with diseases that we can't even think straight. I'm spending all my money on my disease. I'm spending all my time worrying about it if it's going to kill me. I'm spending all the time that I'm forgetting about God except when I want to pray to Him to heal me. Let me tell you something. Down and dirty. God cannot answer your prayer if He already told you what to do and you didn't want to do it and then you pray about it. Do you hear me? It's like saying, dear Lord, bless this pork dinner I'm about to eat with its ham and chitlins, and then this chocolate cake I'm about to eat too, Bless it all in the name of Jesus. Amen. And then we eat this every day. Then we get sick. And then we pray to the Lord to heal us. And we don't stop eating it. Do you think the Lord's going to hear you? If you want to know the Lord's will in your body, it's all in the Bible. It's all in the writings. Ministry of Healing, Councils on Diets and Foods, and things like that. The Lord cannot answer your prayer if you already know what to do and you're purposely not doing it and you're suffering the consequences and then praying for Him to take care of the consequences. It just doesn't work. Okay. Okay, let's see. We forget the top part. What does the Bible say? There's a lot of things. You know, in all those verses, creating me a clean heart, I will give you a new heart, the heart is deceitful above all things, blessed are pure in the heart. How serious does God take the heart? Very serious. Very serious. Your heart, keep your heart with all villages. Let's see. Trust the Lord with all, with part of your heart. Trust the Lord with your four parts of the heart. Only one part He wants. No, He wants all four parts. But remember that when He talks about the heart and the mind are in conjunction to each other. Okay? They work together. Your blood pressure. Any questions about the heart? Okay. Let's talk a little bit about your blood pressure. What is your blood pressure? It involves two numbers when you're taking the blood pressure. One is called systolic. That's when your heart is beating, okay, the pressure. And the other one is called diastolic. That's the lower number. Both are important. Okay, but why do we start getting problems later on in life? Or question, can a person who's 7 years old have blood pressure problems?
Yes.
Yes, of course. Why is a 7-year-old having blood pressure problems?
High sodium level from food.
Could have high problems, sodium, too much sodium. Love that potato chips. I put salt on everything. That could cause it even at 7 years old. I'll tell you, we went to a church in Jersey and we were doing what we call the live and dry blood cell analysis. Does anybody know what that is? Okay, a few of you do. It's when they test your blood, like a diabetic. He pricks his finger and puts the little strip there. Well, this one, we put it on a piece of glass and we show it. And so we decided to take three people from the congregation. A kid, a person in their 30s, 40s, and somebody later in their about 50s or 60s or something like that. And we tested their blood and we showed it up on the screen. Okay? Guess who had the worst blood?
Kid.
The kid. You would think the older person did because all these years they've been eating all this junk.
Nope.
The kid. He 11 years old? Was he about 11? No, he's older, a little older than that. So I would say, let's say he was about 10 years old. And what was his mother doing?
Feeding him.
When she saw him on the blood, see, I told you about those potato chips, you should be eating them and drinking that kind of soda and whatever in church. But wait a minute, who got it for him?
Hello.
Mommy and Daddy.
That's right.
Oh, goodness. Parents, it's an awesome responsibility to have a kid nowadays. Because how they turn out, it's going to be on your head. Okay? So no, the potato chips and the dairy and the ice cream and the candy, I don't care how much the kid cries for it, no. Who's the parent here? You, not the kid. Okay? So, going on, in most people, systolic pressure rises steadily with age due to the increasing stiffness of large arteries, long-term buildup of plaque, and an increased incidence of cardiovascular disease. So what's another word for stiffness of the arteries? Who's hitting? Okay, atherosclerosis. Your veins, which are supposed to be it's hard to move around. Okay? However, elevated systolic or diastolic blood pressure alone may be used to make a diagnosis of high blood pressure. The risk of death from ischemic heart disease and strokes doubles with every 20 points, as I say it. Systolic, which is the upper number, and 10 of the bottom number in ages 40 to 89. But you know that number is going down. It's not 40, it's now lower. Because people are getting sicker at an earlier age now than they are then. So again, what does it mean? Okay, a normal is about 120 and so on down, preferably below 120. How many people take their own blood pressure kind of sometimes? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. That's good. That's good. Okay? You know, just to try sometimes when you're under stress, take your blood pressure and see how it. What stress does to the body is amazing. Truly, truly amazing. The bottom number, okay, is when the heart rests between beats. Okay, this is when the time when the heart fills with blood and gets oxygen. Okay, that should be at least 80. Slightly below is also good. Okay, here's just the red one. The bottom one is hard to read, I know. That's just to give you an idea of what the chart before that did as far as the numbers are concerned. Okay? So they're just saying, you know, normal is this, elevated is this, hypertensive stage 1, 2 is that, etc., etc. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but how many people do you know, if not yourself, that have blood pressure problems? And not to take it, yeah, I'm sure you know a lot of people who do. I'm sure you do. It's not an easy thing to play with. Because if you're high blood pressure, give me a disease, and I'm just thinking of a friend of mine who's 48 and just died of this, of something that happens when your blood pressure is way too high.
So you're an advocate of the problem, not a solution.
Headache? A stroke? If you get headaches on a regular basis, be concerned. Don't take an aspirin because you think it's just stress. Especially if you're getting on a regular basis. A stroke. My friend, I wasn't there. All I know is that he had a major stroke at 48 on Sabbath, last Sabbath, and he went into a coma and they pulled the plug on him on Monday morning because there was no hope. 48 years old. Our lifestyle, and he was overweight. Obesity does play a big part. Why does obesity play a part in a lot of diseases? Stress on your heart, what else? Your heart has to work harder. There's more of you for the heart to pump the blood to. Okay? And it is. So if something is supposed to be, you know, 3 feet and it has to pump to an extra 30 feet, that's a lot of work for the heart to do. Okay? On top of the atherosclerosis, the hardening of the arteries and stuff like that. Okay. You know, how many people did I ask to raise your hands who took blood pressures before? Okay, very good. Have you used the manual kind or the little battery operated one? The battery operated one. Did you know that most people, including nurses and doctors in offices, take the blood pressure the wrong way? Look at the picture. The ones on the left are the wrong way, and the ones on the right are the right way. When you go to a hospital, a doctor's office, a clinic or anything like that, you see what the lady is doing with the stethoscope. How is she holding the stethoscope? Okay, the one with the bell. Look at the top left picture. Right on the center. Oh, if it's open. Okay. That one, it looks, I can't tell. It looks like it's open. Let me see. Yeah, so what is she doing wrong? She's cupping that up, plus she's using her thumb over the part that you're supposed to hear from. And therefore the thumb has its own pulse, so she may be listening to her pulse instead of feeling the patient's. Okay? So that top left picture is wrong. Same thing with, okay, the arm too low. Now most of the time, like that picture shows, it's showing somebody sitting on an exam table versus a regular chair or whatever. And on the exam table, you know, it's bad if you get a short doctor or nurse or something. So the arm is usually down. Having the arm too low will give you a lower reading, but then don't exaggerate and do this either, because then you'll get a different reading either. Ideally, whether you're using the manual or the wrist one, it should, where's your heart, by the way? Where's your heart? Heart, okay, it's in the middle, slightly leaning towards. So your hand, your arm, I should say, should be at heart level. So if you happen to be sitting down anywhere, just take the arm, prop up the arm of the person, whoever it is that you're doing, even yourself, okay? Now, that was one thing. Now, you just pointed out something. Okay, what if I put it up here? Okay, let me tell you about that. Anybody ever work with a water hose? A water hose? Okay, now what happens if you bend it or pinch it? It doesn't flow. It's no different from your arm. It's too tight here. You are cutting off the blood flow, so do not do this either. Have it loose. It's about my heart level. And like I said, prop it up on something if you're sitting down. Okay? Prop it up if you're sitting down. Same thing if you're taking even the wrist one. If you're doing the wrist, then have it, because they're usually sitting at, like, maybe your table or desk, wherever they're sitting at, then just take something and just put it, even if it's a book or something. If they can't hold their arm up to heart level, then either you hold it if you don't get tired, or prop it up with something. But the point is, this is wrong, that's wrong, and this is wrong. Okay, do you understand why? Okay, keep on going here. Oh, wait a minute. So here, the way he's doing it up on the right-hand side is correct. She's doing it correct, and the other one down below is doing it correct. There are more than one kind of wrist type. Wrist machines, you gotta make sure that it's open. You always have extra batteries. That's the problem with those. But not only that, but they also, you have to read each monitor, because some of them may say, put it over here, put it over here, or put it over here. So you have to read, because if you just slap it on, and again have their arm down, or maybe have it up too high or something like that, then you're gonna have an issue. You notice how the one on the in the middle, the top, has it on the side, and then one has it on the inside, and there's some that are here also on either side. But pay attention to the type of cuff that you are buying and using. And the size. Obviously, even with the regular manual BP cuffs, they have small. You're not gonna do an adult one on a little child whose wrist is like that small, obviously. So they have one for children, one for adults, and then they have extra large for people who are obese and have arms that are too big for the regular size cuffs. Okay? Another thing, there's things to tell them to do, and I forgot to write some of them, but that one is basically don't drink or drink kind of coffee, don't eat or drink like coffee or any kind of beverages that have caffeine in it, or smoke within 30 minutes of doing your blood pressure. Another thing you need to do also is when you're ready to take a blood pressure and the person is walking from one room to the other, you tell them sit down and then you take it, no. Give them at least 5 minutes to let them before you take their blood pressure. That's what that is also saying. Sit still with your back straight, your feet on the floor. No, do not sit there with your legs crossed, you know, either at your ankles or whatever. Uncross the legs, have them flat on the floor, okay? If you're going to do it yourself, check it at the same time every day, because different times of the day, your body goes through some rhythm throughout the day, okay? And if you're taking it one day at this time, another day at this time, you will not get good readings. Check your blood pressure 2-3 times. Wait a minute before each reading. In our home center, lifestyle center, we do it in 4 different ways. When you're sitting, we take the pressure on one side, the other side, while you're sitting, laying down, and standing up, because all 4 will tell us something. If the numbers are like, woo, totally different, when you're doing it on left and right, something's not right. What do you think is the problem? Circulation problem somewhere along the line. Yes, exactly. Okay. Is there such a thing as low blood pressure? Oh, yes. Most people have high blood pressure, but there are some people who are actually low. And if you're looking at the symptoms there, a lot of them are kind of similar. But there is a difference. And do you know having it too low can be just as dangerous as having it too high? You see the symptoms up there? I'm not going to read it. I'm not going to go into it. You can look at it briefly. But there is such a thing as people having it too low. And that's I would venture to say, of the people who have blood pressure problems, more than 90% are high, or more than that. Okay, you see the symptoms up there. Okay? High blood pressure. What are some of the issues? Okay? Lack of physical activity. People who have sit-down jobs at a computer all day will have a lot more health issue than somebody who is more active. I'm a construction worker, I'm on the move, or I make deliveries, I'm constantly moving. But if I'm sitting there all day, and that's all I do, I'm gonna have more issues than somebody who's active just by sitting. Inactivity is extremely important. Genetics, of course, stress and anxiety, my diet, alcohol, my smoking, my caffeine. Remember that caffeine is not just found in coffee. Let me tell you an experience about caffeine. Many, 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 many years ago, I was having pain in my chest. And I went to the doctor. He was like, "Doctor, I'm too young to have breast cancer. Oh, please, doctor." Well, you think the worst. If I'm having pain, it's like, oh, that's it, I have cancer. That's your first idea, right? Because I would be having it every day. So I'm on the table and she's examining me, poking me all over the place. And she gets over here and she says, "Anna, you gotta stop drinking coffee." I said, "I don't drink coffee." And then she keeps going. She says, "Let's stay off the chocolate." I busted out laughing. I said, "How did she know I eat chocolate? I love chocolate." Wait. What did they say in Alcoholics Anonymous? "Hi, my name is Anna. I'm a chocolate-holic." Okay? And so she said, "Yeah, it has caffeine in it." You know, deep down inside, I knew that, but I still love my chocolate. Chocolate anything. So I decided to prove her wrong. I decided to stop eating chocolate, because at my job, every day I came in, there on the counter was some chocolate candies. Every single day I'd be eating chocolate. Every single day! Except Saturday and Sunday, because I wasn't working. Okay? But if the church had some chocolate I needed, someday I would find something to eat. I was a chocolateholic. So I decided to prove her wrong. No, not going to touch the chocolate. Within 2 days, my pain went away. I said, ooh, I don't believe it. So I stayed away and stayed away and stayed away. No more pain. And I went back to the doctor and I said, now why was I getting pain in my breast? She says, Anna, we women have cysts in our breast. And this is what chocolate does. To my cysts. I said, really? I said, wow. So I stopped eating chocolate for the longest time. Ah, how nice it is not to have pain in my breast. Because ladies, if you think you are tender when you have a period, woo-wee, that ain't nothing compared to what I felt. And I said, okay, but boy, did I miss my chocolate. I missed it. So one day, weeks later, I felt a little bing. I said, oh, man, she's right. So I had to stop my caffeine. So I said, okay, no problem. But what else has caffeine other than chocolate? Sodas. Tea. Oh my goodness, everything I love has caffeine in it. But you know what? I had to do what I had to do. Because what do I want? Do I want the pain for the sake of my appetite? Which is going to keep me out of heaven eventually? Or am I willing to stop it for the sake of my health and obedience to the Word of God? Which one did I choose? You don't see me complaining now, so you know which one I chose. Okay, cut down on the caffeine, exercise regularly, eat healthy, lose the weight, stop smoking, cut down on salt, and limit alcohol. All of those will affect your blood pressure as well as other things. The results of high blood pressure, damage to your arteries, an aneurysm. Do you know what an aneurysm is? Take a balloon and blow it up. But visualize that inside your arteries. You have an aneurysm, you can bleed to death and basically die. Heart failure, block or ruptured vessels, reduced kidney function, vision loss, loss of cognitive function, concentration, your memory, ability to learn. How many people say, where did I park my car? I forgot. Where did I leave my keys? You know, all these things are signs of deterioration sooner or later. Metabolic syndrome, okay, sometimes there are no symptoms as blood pressure increases, but eventually you're going to get signs other than a headache, confusions, ears, noise buzzing, irregular heartbeat, nosebleed, tiredness, vision changing, and again, these are some of the things that are listed that will cause your blood pressure to go up. Okay, what kind of foods are good for high blood pressure? You know what, it doesn't matter whether you have cancer, high blood pressure, diabetes, even fibromyalgia, I don't care what your issues is, the answer will always be the same. Eat healthy. Fiber foods. Why are foods that are rich in fiber important? They clean out your colon. And what do they say about your colon? What is that?
All disease starts in the colon.
There you go. Diseases start in your colon, and you say, wait a minute, my colon's down here. What does that have to do with my heart? My colon's down here. What does that have to do with my lungs? My colon is down here. What does that have to do with my kidneys? What does that have to do with anything if they're so disconnected? But they're not disconnected. Okay? They're far away from each other, but death and disease starts in the colon. You clean that out, you'd be surprised how much that you will be healthier. Unprocessed foods, in other words, give me an example of a processed food. What's a processed food? White rice?
No.
Okay.
Anything acidic, yeah.
What else?
Cereals?
What processed foods are White flour, anything that's made from white flour, anything that's canned, all these kind of different things are processed. And so we want to eat unprocessed foods that are high in fiber, like fruits and veggies and seeds. Okay, you want to cut down on your sodium, high sodium foods. You want to watch keeping your potassium, because if you eat too much, it will lower the other minerals, okay? It's like having 20, I eat 20 bananas a day. That's not good. Because remember, all your functions in your body aren't generated, don't move or don't work because of one mineral. They work synergistically. They work together. If you have too much of something, it's going to lower the effects of the other minerals. Okay? Let's see. Omega-3s and omega-6s. Make sure you eat a lot of garlic, dark leafy green vegetables, etc., etc. Get your exercise, drink a lot of water, and learn to de-stress. Stress affects every organ of the body. It affects every disease. So we got to be careful there. Did you know that emotions, and I think the sister here mentioned it earlier, emotions can affect all our organs. Look at this. If you have your cameras, this is a picture you need to take of. Yes. If you have your phone cameras, okay? This is what you should do. Do you know that impatience and hate can affect intestinal and heart health, cause palpitations, chest pain, and hypertension? We're talking emotions now, okay? Depression and melancholy can affect our large intestine, our skin, our lungs. Common symptoms of which are constipation, low blood oxygen count, and breathing difficulties. How about envy, frustration, anger? Okay? They have a negative effect, not only on our eyes, our gallbladder, the liver. Okay? Symptoms include, and you can read, how about fear? How many people fear things? Oh, you know, I'm worried about this. I fear this. My husband this. Or the IRS is coming after me. Or whatever. You live in constant fear. This fear affects your urinary bladder, your kidneys, your ears. Okay? The symptoms are poor sexual stamina, disorders of the nervous system, excess acid production in the body, and you know over here that I have knots in my stomach? That's caused by fear. Mistrust, anxiety, and worry can lead to poor digestion, difficulty with regard to waste elimination. In other words, you can't go get rid of waste. These emotions usually have a negative effect on the stomach, spleen, and pancreatic health. Emotions play a big part in our health. Negative emotions, which means that the opposite must be true. If I'm always negative, and I get